Hey, welcome to Recalibrate this afternoon. Thank you for joining us as we continue on in our Fruits of the Spirit. Today we're going to be talking about goodness. And goodness, it was quite the rain we got this last weekend. I enjoyed every second of it, including the extremely slippery, muddy conditions of gravel roads. I wasn't too pleased with that, but hey, I'll take it if it means we get all the rain that we got. It was phenomenal. So thankful for how the Lord takes care of us and how he brings the rain, and it was very, very welcome. And I just, I love it. If it rained like 4 out of the 7 days every week, I would be okay with that. I love rain so much. All right, well, we're continuing on, and we're looking at goodness and fruits of the Spirit. And if you're like me, when I was growing up, I always wondered why would the fruits of the Spirit include kindness and goodness, thinking that they were so similar, they were so much the same. What would be the point of including both? And I think there's definitely differences. And Larry shared last week, and so this week I'm just going to be looking at goodness and going on. And I remember when I was growing up and stuff, there would always be those jokers, those people that would say stuff to, well, not to get a reaction, but you know, they'd say stuff. And I remember one thing that was said often was when I was at a dinner table, for instance, and people were passing around food and saying, oh, do you want some more potatoes? Do you want some more greens or whatever? And then if it came to me and I was like, no, I'm good, someone would look at you and go, no one's good. No, not even one. What are you talking about? And you know, and I'm guilty of it too. I've said it a couple times in a sermon or two here and there, and the classic eye roll of, oh, okay, well, I guess nobody's good. But you know, it's true that nobody is good, not even one. Psalm 14:1 says that. And the problem these days, what we've done with the word goodness as a word has these days the wow factor of a granola bar. We've kind of taken the word good and we've dumbed it down a lot to the point where you could be having a pretty awful day, but someone asks you how you're doing and then you just respond with good, because the truth would take too long, and also I can just say good, then that's kind of the universal signal to stop asking me more questions. Not always the case, but it gets that rap. Goodness has lost a lot of its meaning. The word has lost a lot of its weight. And what makes me think of that is how when God created the heavens and the earth in Genesis, and at the end of each day, the Lord saw what he had made and he said it was good. God wasn't just saying, like, God was making a perfect world. He was making a perfect environment. He was making a perfect ecosystem. He was making a perfect relationship between sun and darkness and the tides and the ground and the birds and the animal, everything he made, and it was good. And I don't think God was sitting there going, good, you know, like how we might use that word today. When God said it was good, it was good. And the definition of good means not bad at all. There's no bad. It's only good. And when they called him good teacher in Mark 10:18, Jesus said, why do you call me good? None is good but the Father. So when we read about how the Bible defines good, we quickly realize that good is a powerful word, actually. It's a powerful descriptor of God himself. When God says he's good, he's not just saying he's meh, or he's okay, or he's mediocre, or he's like 75%, he's good 100%. And if we take the definition of good just to mean that we don't kill people, or we don't rob, or we don't swear at people, or, you know, then the understanding of goodness of God actually becomes more difficult. Because if we define goodness as, you know, basically all right, then we talk about the goodness of God, it doesn't cause us to think more deeply about the goodness of God. It kind of cheapens it. The word good gets cheapened. And that's why today when we talk about, you know, being a good person, yeah, we want to be a good person. We want to do the right things, but we also have to understand that we actually can never be good enough. You know, we can be, if we're talking percentages, we can be at a good percentage of things we do well, but by definition, we are actually never good. We're actually never good enough compared to the standard of goodness that God has given us in his word. And that's a tough pill to swallow, because we hear all the time that be a good person. But then when you read the Bible and you realize that just because you think you're good, that doesn't have enough weight to carry you into glory. But then we keep reading the Bible, and we keep reading about the goodness of God and how God is good, how God is wonderful. He's kind. He's gracious. He's so good that he sent his son into the world to die for sinners like you and me who weren't good enough. And he died so that we could be counted as good. Because if we have faith in him, if we put our faith in him and believe in him, then his righteousness becomes our righteousness and his goodness becomes our goodness. And we'll still struggle with the daily struggles of sinfulness in this world. We'll still struggle with that till the day we're glorified. But when we look at the goodness of God, and when we look at how he is the definition of goodness, like we talked about this last Sunday, he's the definition of righteous. He's also the definition of goodness. Goodness in the Bible is 100% goodness. It's not just in passing. And so that's just a bit of a moment to kind of like pause and just reflect on what the Bible's definition of goodness is. It's completely sinless. It's completely untainted by the sinfulness of the world. And we know that only Jesus is that level of goodness. And one day when we are with him in heaven, we'll share in that goodness and fully, without any hindrances of sin. And that's something so good to look forward to. And then as I was continuing on reading, I came to Galatians 6, verse 9. Well, actually, we'll start in verse 6. Galatians 6, starting in verse 6. Let the one who's taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good. For in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. And what caught my attention was, as we're talking about goodness, and then we're kind of coming to the conclusion that no one is good, not even one. So what does it mean, don't grow weary of doing good? Well, the really cool thing is the fruits of the Spirit is the fruit of the Holy Spirit working through us. So it's not, when we read the list of fruits of the Spirit, it's not that we're the ones that are making perfect peace or perfect love or perfect joy. We in ourselves aren't responsible for that. But the Holy Spirit is responsible through working in us as we're willingly obedient to the leading of the Spirit and his work in us. And so when we come to this verse, let us not grow weary in doing good, it's really cool because it's kind of a reminder that, again, like, don't grow weary in following the Holy Spirit. Do not grow weary in following God. Don't worry about being perfect, because no one is. No one can be. Only Jesus was perfect. But be obedient. Don't grow weary of being obedient and following after God. Because when we are obedient and following after God, and when we're striving and we're recognizing the importance of it, and we're giving him our hearts daily, then he's able to work in our obedient, submissive hearts to bring out his goodness. And that's what will be seen. So it's really cool. It's really wonderful that the goodness of God is so good. It's so good. It's 100%. It's not lacking. It's not kind of. It's 100% good. And God works in us in his goodness by his Holy Spirit to bring about these fruits. And here we have a reminder and an encouragement to keep in step with the Spirit. Let's keep in step. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. And it all starts in humility, being humble, in recognizing that what God says is true and right and is profitable for teaching us and growing us and leading us. And then to keep in step means to follow what he says, to pursue these things, and to be obedient so that God will be able to work in us to bring about these fruits of the Spirit. And to not grow weary in doing it, because we all get weary because we have a sinful nature that is constantly at war with us. And when we're constantly warring against following God versus following ourselves, that brings about a weariness. And it can be a confusing weariness because we're not always thinking, oh, my sinfulness is fighting against my wanting to follow God. We don't usually remember that. But we can know that God gives strength to us as we wage this daily battle. And the goodness of God is infinitely greater than the sinfulness of me, infinitely greater than the sinfulness of anybody watching. And so we can be confident that his goodness will bring us to completion. He will complete his good work in you, is what the Bible says. And so it's something worth celebrating. It's something worth being so excited about. And my prayer is that it would cause us to be excited, and it would cause us to be prayerful, and to be just so excited to follow, and so excited to see his goodness worked in our hearts day by day through obedience to his word. Thank you, Father, so much for this day. Thank you for your goodness, and that your goodness is great. I pray, Father, that you'd help us to continue to learn from your word, continue to follow you, and be shown your goodness more and more each day as we follow. I pray you give us the strength we need to follow you, and when we feel weary, to acknowledge that to you and to others, and to find rest for our hearts that can only come from you. I pray you please guide us and go before us in the rest of this week. We praise you that you are a good Father, you are a loving Father, and you take care of your children. We thank you for that. In your precious name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great rest of your week. We'll see you later.